Hi everyone, my name is Njenga Hakina. I am the Africa Climate Editor at the China Global South Project. Just before we get to today's podcast, I want to update you on the work we are doing at CGSP. While there is extensive news coverage on China's relations with the United States, Europe, and the current situation involving Taiwan, the same cannot be said for its interactions with developing countries, also referred to as the Global South. Unfortunately, there is a lack of comprehensive reporting in this area, and this is precisely where our team comes in. We have a dedicated group of editors who are in Africa, Asia, the Middle East, and who diligently report on these stories in real time every day. Furthermore, we make it a point to provide our content in three languages. We have it in English, in French, and in Arabic. If you'd like to join our growing community of readers from around the world, go to ChinaGlobalSouth/subscribe. And subscriptions start at just $19 a month. Once again, that's ChinaGlobalSouth.com/subscribe. Thank you.
The China in Africa podcast is brought to you in partnership with the Africa-China Reporting Project at Wits University in Johannesburg. The ACRP promotes balanced, considered reporting on China-Africa relations through training programs held throughout the year. More information at africachinareporting.com.
Hello and welcome to another edition of the China in Africa podcast, a proud member of the Seneca Podcast Network. I'm Eric Olander, and as always, I'm joined by China Global South's managing editor, Cobus van Staden, joining us from Berlin, Germany. A very good afternoon to you, Cobus.
Good afternoon.
Cobus, just a very quick apology from our part. Earlier this week, we tried to produce a China Global South episode from the Africa Climate Summit in Nairobi, but unfortunately, there was no bandwidth in Nairobi. When you throw down 300,000 people into a convention center in downtown Nairobi, they apparently sucked up all of the bandwidth in the city. And our guest, David McNair from the One Campaign, was unable to join us. Cobus, I was very disappointed because I have a lot to say about the Africa Climate Summit, and I am just ready to rip into this thing. Oh my God.
The African Climate Summit is maybe a bit relieved.
So we're going to do a show with David on the African Climate Summit, and also we want to touch on the ASEAN Climate Forum that took place also this week in Jakarta on the sidelines of the ASEAN Leaders Summit that is also taking place there. So lots of climate summits and climate conferences coming up that we're going to talk about. Today, we're going to talk about Africa-ASEAN relations. Now, that's Africa-Southeast Asia relations, and it's a very interesting dynamic because a lot of people, when they think of Asia, they're thinking primarily of India, China, and Japan. And so today we're going to deep dive into why Southeast Asia, where I'm at here in Vietnam, is absolutely critical for African countries and becoming even more important. And that was plainly evident just last week, in fact, when Indonesian President Joko Widodo visited four African countries at the end of the BRICS summit that took place in Johannesburg. He made stops, in addition to South Africa, in Kenya, Mozambique, and Tanzania. In South Africa, the president closed a deal to import 300,000 tons of soybean along with 50,000 cattle. In Kenya, he held talks with President William Ruto about Nairobi joining ASEAN. And South Africa, by the way, is also an observer to ASEAN. So interesting that they might want to bring Kenya along. And also for Joko Widodo, the appeal of gaining access to the African Continental Free Trade Area and using Kenya as a gateway was a topic of discussion as well. So bringing Indonesian goods into the African market is something that he is looking at. Here in Vietnam, trade with African countries more than doubled from 2010 to last year to more than $5.5 billion. And part of that trade, Cobus, is coming from your country in South Africa. Just down the street at my local supermarket, we're seeing a lot of new produce from pears, apples, oranges, and other agricultural products coming from South Africa. So that's kind of cool. But the big player in the region is Singapore. Last year, two-way trade between Singapore and Africa totaled almost $20 billion, about $19.4 billion, which is quite remarkable when you consider that Singapore has a population of just 5.5 million people. Now, To be sure, not all that $20 billion worth of goods is staying in Singapore. Singapore is a transshipment area for the rest of Southeast Asia. It's a major trading hub. But it's really important to understand the importance that Singapore places in all of this. But it's not just in the trade side of the equation. Also, when it comes to FDI in Africa, the Singaporeans, you know, are hitting way above their weight. It's somewhere between $20 and $30 billion. We're getting numbers from the Singaporean government that says it's $23 billion. Singapore Private Enterprise Association say it's $32 billion, which leads me to think that the Singaporeans are dealing with a typo somewhere in that. But it's in the tens of billions of dollars that the Singaporeans are investing in Africa, something that I think goes unnoticed. And a lot of people, little fun fact here, may not be aware that it's a Singaporean firm, Tolaram Group, that was one of the major investors in the new port of Lekki in Lagos, Nigeria. And so that gives you a sense that these guys in Singapore are playing in the big leagues with the Chinese and the French to build major infrastructure projects like that in Lekki, which is now West Africa's largest deep water port. So Cobus, when you consider ASEAN as a market, and this is something that surprises a lot of people, it's absolutely enormous. We're talking about 11 countries in this region with a population of more than 600 million people, which is about half the size of the entire African continent, and a market size of $3.66 trillion, 20% larger, in fact, than all of Africa's GDP. So there's a lot of opportunity here. But as I mentioned at the top of the show, though, when African stakeholders often think of Asia, they're flattening out the continent, much the same way that people flatten out Africa when they talk about Africa. And again, I'm putting up air quotes here because Africa is just a terrible word to describe a diverse region of 54 countries, the same way that Asia is a terrible word to describe a continent as rich and diverse and multifaceted as what we have out here. So beyond India, China, and Japan, there are all these other countries. And with Joko Widodo's visit and the increase in trade between African and ASEAN countries, I'm starting to think that there's good reason that the perspectives both in Africa and here in ASEAN are starting to change.
I think so too. I mean, as you mentioned, South African produce exporters are increasingly leaning into trade with ASEAN. I think also in response to trade with Russia largely evaporating, you know, South African produce exporters were selling quite a lot in Russia. And so they were very actively looking for other markets beyond Russia and beyond China. And ASEAN is very attractive to them. I think in a lot of ways, more broadly, there's a lot the two can talk about. You know, I think they have actually in lots of ways a lot more overlap between them than, say, with China, particularly because ASEAN is so diverse. It, you know, so many languages, so many religions, you know, lots of kind of complicated history, a very complicated colonial history. So there's a lot there that is kind of overlaps and a lot that Africa can take from how ASEAN managed to integrate so closely economically.
That's right. And the lessons extend beyond economic for both sides. Again, this is not, you know, Asian countries teaching Africa or African countries teaching Asian countries. In ASEAN in particular, as you mentioned, there's a shared colonial history. There's also the fragmentation that we see in Africa is equal here in Southeast Asia. There's not a common religion, ethnicity, a language, very, very fragmented in that respect as well. And then also, and I thought you were going to go there, in terms of the solidarity that dates back to the 1955 Bandung Forum between Africa and Asian countries wanting to stay out of the Cold War. And there is a similar desire today to keep your head down from the burgeoning great power competition between the U.S. and China as well. So lots of symmetry there. The timing for our discussion today about African-ASEAN relations is absolutely perfect, though, because last week, 500 business and government leaders from 40 countries, including 14 from Africa, flew out here to attend the Africa-Singapore Business Forum. It's one of those things, and it just pained me. It's just one of those things I wish I could have gone. I mean, Singapore's less than an hour away from me here in Saigon. So hopefully next year I'll have a chance to go. But for now, let's get a perspective from someone who was there and helped to moderate the event. Amit Jain is the director of the NTU-SBF Center for African Studies at the Nanyang Business School in Singapore, which is Southeast Asia's only think tank dedicated to focusing specifically on Africa. And notably, take note, it's rooted in the business school, not in any of the other areas of the university. Normally, Africa studies programs are in the development schools or public policy, and here it's in the business school, so that's very interesting. Amit, welcome to the program, and thank you so much for staying up late to join us.
Thank you very much for having me here, Eric and Cobus. It's a real honor for me to be on your podcast. Thank you.
The honor is really mutual. We've been a longtime admirer of the work that you're doing in Singapore at the center. Let's first start with the conference. We'll get that out of the way before we deep dive into some of the other issues. This was a big deal in Singapore. A lot of attention was generated from it. There were some great speeches, and I saw the reaction from a lot of African stakeholders who walked away very enthusiastic. Maybe just before we get started, give us a few of the highlights of what you discussed and what the reaction was from participants.
Okay, Eric, you know, this Africa-Singapore Business Forum is held once every 2 years. So the conference that you would get to attend next would not be 2024, but 2025.
Oh, yeah. I got to wait 2 more years. Okay, I'll be there in 2 years, though.
Yes. The focus this time was on digitalization, manufacturing, and stability. And sustainability, I beg your pardon. So these are the new areas where Singapore would like to pivot to. As you know, most of Singapore's private sector engagement with the continental Africa has largely been overwhelmingly agribusiness sector. It is a big commodity trading hub. And besides the big commodity traders, the likes of Olam and Trafigura and others, Wilmar, there is a long tail of smaller traders, unknown traders, who source commodities of various types from different African markets. The pivot is looking to the future. So the session that I moderated looked at manufacturing, particularly high-value manufacturing, and consumer trade. So those are the two areas that we covered during my panel.
And broadly, like the focus on digitalization, what kind of aspects of digitalization and digital economies were the delegates particularly interested in?
Well, if you look at what's the trend that is happening is you have a collection of small and agile startups based out of Singapore that are experimenting with fintech, using technology to facilitate trade. That's one thing that a lot of African countries are interested in, and health tech. So these are an e-commerce. So these are the things that are beginning to find traction, and it's been test-bedded in many parts of Asia. You know, as Eric was describing earlier, you know, Southeast Asia is as diverse a place as it can get. And a lot of the learnings from the e-commerce and from fintech and from technology startups working in these markets is to see whether that can be replicated in continental Africa. They certainly seem to think it will. How far that will go, time will tell.
It's been a long-held dream in many parts of Africa that as China offshores more of its manufacturing, much of which has come here to Southeast Asia and a lot of it to South Asia, Bangladesh and Pakistan has gotten quite a bit of it, there's been the dream that some of it's going to go to Africa. So you said that manufacturing was on the agenda. Very little of the manufacturing from China has actually made it into Africa, other than small and medium-sized enterprises that are making stuff for the African markets and not necessarily for export. So when the discussions are happening in Singapore at a forum like this about manufacturing, do the concerns come up about power, infrastructure, supply chains, all the things that make Southeast Asia so effective and so easy for not only Chinese companies, but Singaporeans and others to operate here, and which Africa has a reputation, I'm not sure it's true, but it certainly has a reputation, that it's not as cost-effective and as convenient for manufacturers to use as a base to export to Europe and to the United States and other parts of the world. Tell us a little bit more of that manufacturing discussion that took place.
No, absolutely. There is a lot of myth around why Africa has not industrialized. But when a lot of the guests who were in the forum heard the representative from the IFC speak, he described it as such. He looked at this, look at Vietnam and Cambodia. Back in the 1970s or 80s, the wage gap between these countries versus, let's say, Ghana and others was big. African labor was far more expensive for low-cost manufacturing than these countries. But that gap has narrowed. So perhaps there is, so has the kind of infrastructure, availability of power, roads. In fact, there were no special economic zones in that era. There are now. So it is possible to build out manufacturing units in Africa in many different parts today than it was possible earlier. And one good example that you mentioned a short while ago is the Lagos Free Zone in Nigeria, set up by a Singapore firm called Tolaram. That is perfect, a showcase for, you know, small manufacturing units to come up.
So do you get a sense that in exploring these options, is Southeast Asia particularly taking lessons from what China has managed to achieve and not achieve in Africa? Or are they looking more broadly beyond China to, you know, other Asian, like, you know, giants like Japan, for example, or to Europe in terms of kind of lessons for how to succeed in Africa?
Yeah, well, you know, one of the things that they want to keep eye on is market access. As Vietnam and Cambodia, Bangladesh, you know, move out of the low income category, they are likely to lose preferential market access to, you know, the markets of Europe and the US. And then they look at Africa and then they see that opportunity still there, at least for a lot longer than it might exist in Southeast Asia. And so when manufacturers start to think on those lines, then they see, you know, perhaps it's time to pivot. They also see the fact that a lot of the countries in Southeast Asia have made commitments of carbon reduction and the net zero commitments that many of these companies have made. It makes sense for them to take a look at Africa a lot more seriously, given many of the countries, especially in East Africa, for example, are, you know, the energy is largely coming from non-renewable sources. So that would allow them again an edge in getting access to the bigger markets of the West.
Well, let's pick up that theme a little bit in terms of who's learning what from who. And I'd like you to answer this question from both sides. So at conferences like the one that you participated in last week in Singapore, you've obviously spent a lot of time in Africa and elsewhere here in Southeast Asia. Let's first start with, what are the questions that people in Southeast Asia, and maybe let's go beyond Singapore, because in some ways Singapore tends to be a more cosmopolitan place than other parts of Southeast Asia. I'm thinking Laos, here in Vietnam, the Philippines and Indonesia, among others. What are the questions that they have about Africa? And then when you're interacting with African stakeholders, what are the questions that they have about Southeast Asia? And do you get a sense that they have an interest or a baseline knowledge of the complexity of the regions?
I think the veneer is thin. The understanding is not there yet. So let me start by, you know, when Africans think of Asia, they are indeed thinking mostly of China, Japan, and maybe India. But among the ruling elites, among the people who frame policies, there is a special place for ASEAN, not least because this is a region whose experiment with industrialization and regional integration has some learnings for them. So that, you know, has a calling card. Manufacturing, as I was mentioning earlier, that has a calling card. If you look at small republics like Rwanda and Mauritius, they have more or less copy-pasted their economic development board on the EDB of Singapore. So they see a lot in common with Singapore. Small countries in difficult neighborhoods, agile, they have to be agile. Singapore's reputation for good governance, that has a calling. Investment in human capital, that's something they look at. Urban planning, trade dependency. Some of them are managed democracies with one-party dominance, almost like would like to replicate a corporatized state. So I met a gentleman from Ghana, for example, who waxed eloquent about Lee Kuan Yew and his book, From Third World to the First. Other countries in Southeast Asia, certainly they look at Thailand and Vietnam, and they look at how quickly their per capita income has risen as compared to what they were back in the 1960s. So if anything, it serves more as an inspiration for the Africans when they look at ASEAN. Investors in Asia have the same old tropes about Africa that you often find in the West. One, a place where infrastructure is crumbling, which, you know, in many cases, it's far from reality. It has improved significantly in many places. Lack of human capital. What they don't recognize is that today's youth in Africa is far more educated than their grandparents were. And so they can find talented human capital should they choose to take that plunge. And very sophisticated consumer market. This is something, shockingly, many investors out of Asia have not yet come to recognize about Africa.
And do you see similar kind of issues when you look at the financing landscape and investment landscape particularly? Do you see similar kind of inflated risk premiums being kind of calculated in those conversations as one sometimes sees from Global North investors?
Oh, absolutely. You just took the words out of my mouth, Cobus. I mean, I think the real game changer would be finance. So if you look at Singapore's asset management industry, it manages an asset portfolio worth $4 trillion out of Singapore, right? Put everybody in that sector together. This is a scale that rivals almost all the wealth hubs in the world. But critical to note is that 90% of that is invested outside, 45% in APEC countries, 21% in North America, 10% in Singapore itself, 13% in Europe, and 11% elsewhere. Now, guess how much would that be going to Africa? Less than 2%, if at all. There are two major sovereign wealth funds here, Temasek and GIC. Between them, they manage something like $950 billion worth of asset under management. Barely 1% of their portfolio is connected to Africa. Barely 1%. So that tells you there's so much more room there. And yes, you're right. The perception that it is far riskier to invest in any African country than, say, Myanmar, you know, that kind of thinking still exists, I'm afraid.
I guess it's closeness breeds familiarity, right?
Correct.
So the fact that it's just so close. But when we look at Temasek, and by the way, for those of you who are not familiar with Temasek, Temasek is, correct me if I'm wrong here, it's the government's sovereign wealth fund. So this is the state. And again, you would think that the state would have a slightly broader view on some of these issues than a purely private fund, but apparently not. What will it take, do you think, to get organizations like Temasek to be more sophisticated about investing in Africa? Is it education? Is it trips over there? Is it facilitating meet and greets? What needs to happen here?
Well, look, I mean, their foray into Africa has been relatively recent. They have small exposure, like Tana Africa Capital, for example, $150 million. They focus mostly on agriculture, consumer sector. Some of their exposure has been in the energy sector. They try and take more of a co-investment strategy, do not like to go it alone. But once these investments start to, you know, pay dividends, start to show returns, which almost in most cases is better than dollar for dollar, sector for sector comparison with their exposure in Western markets, then hopefully they will start to hire fund managers with experience in having invested in Africa, and that might tip the balance. That might change.
And Cobus, let me put the question to you as well, because Temasek and these Singaporean sovereign wealth funds, we're just talking again just about Singapore here, at almost $1 trillion of potential capital. Obviously, that's going into a lot of different places, but it's a pool of capital that is potentially up for grabs. You would think that African countries, now that they're should be recognizing that the flow of money coming from China has fallen precipitously and will probably not rebound anytime soon, may now be on the lookout for new sources of capital. And Singapore, Southeast Asia is one of them. It's a very capital-rich area for some parts of it, not all of it, some parts of it. But the problem in many African countries, including your own in South Africa, is that area studies tends to be a weak spot. That is, focusing on these sub-regions within a continent like Southeast Asia, that explains in part why the knowledge and understanding of the finer points of politics, culture, and history in Southeast Asia remains quite weak, even in places like South Africa, which has some of the strongest knowledge production hubs on the continent. What do you think needs to happen? So the same question I'm asking Amit, I want to ask you, what do you think needs to happen to get Africans more interested and engaged into what's going on here in Southeast Asia?
So yeah, it's an interesting question. I think South Africa and other African countries are to a certain extent still trying to catch up with Asian studies more generally. You know, so even Chinese studies or Japanese studies, Korean studies, it's still tough to get access to those in many African universities. And I think one of the issues is just that the African education system has for so long been beholden to the global north, to Europe and to the United States. So encouraging those areas of study, like area studies, is one thing, and encouraging peer learning is another one. And then also leaning into some of the pre-existing connections that already exist between these regions. So particularly in South Africa has quite strong historical connections with Indonesia because of shared colonial legacies. There's you know, kind of people from Indonesian lineage, you know, kind of now in South Africa many years later. And so there's a lot of opportunities there, but I think it's from on both sides. It's also, you know, seeing the value, mobilizing the money, and creating the scholar networks, and that frequently takes time, and it takes management that is kind of attuned to the possibilities there. So I think making that case and making that, you know, more clear, I think would be very helpful.
Do you see any of that happening with regards to Southeast Asia?
To a certain extent, you know, I know some academics at South African universities who specifically focus on Southeast Asia and South Asia, you know, kind of in connection sometimes. So, you know, that is happening. But what frequently is the situation is that this is pushed by individuals. And what one actually needs are kind of meta networks, kind of institutional networks. Yeah. You know,
I guess that's like what Amit's doing here in terms of facilitating these kinds of discussions.
Exactly. Yeah.
Amit, let me just bring up one other interesting point here, is that Southeast Asia is emerging as one of the major hubs for production of critical minerals that are used to manufacture electric vehicle batteries. I'm thinking of nickel coming out of Indonesia, lithium in the Philippines. Actually, it turns out that Indonesia is also a major hub for cobalt, second only to the Democratic Republic of Congo. Indonesia pioneered some new laws that restricted the export of raw nickel that in many ways were copied by Zimbabwe and their new mineral laws. And now Namibia has done the same. And I'm just wondering if there's ways, I don't know if they're looking at each other, but it certainly seems that this is a new opportunity for Southeast Asian and African countries to collaborate with one another, because everything is new. Everybody's trying to figure this out. The Chinese are big players in the nickel business and in the cobalt business in the DRC and also in the lithium business in Zimbabwe. Were critical minerals part of the discussion at the business conference that you held in Singapore? And talk to us a little bit about the conversations that you're having in that realm.
That is so true. I'm almost certain that Indonesia's decision to compel investors into investing in cobalt beneficiation, moving up the value chain, certainly had some effect in many of the African countries as well, although it's hard to connect it immediately. But during my panel, we had a major Singapore-based mining and shipping operator that is a part of SMB, a consortium that has bauxite and iron ore, you know, concessions.
Is that Trafigura?
No, it's called Winning Group. It's a Singapore-registered firm.
But so it's Chinese-owned though, right?
It's a Chinese-owned, yes. So he was part of my panel, ironically, in a panel that was addressing the issue of manufacturing. And, you know, I put to him, what would it take really for the processing of those raw materials that they are currently shipping to China, making, you know, aluminum and fine quality steel, to be happening in Guinea? And he says, it'll take time. So there is no real answer at this stage. A serious interest, at least as far as the extractive industry is concerned, to consider going in that direction. Things have changed on the agribusiness sector, though. A lot of the traders that used to be pure play commodity traders have now started to invest in cashew factories, cashew processing units. And I'm not talking about just the big ones like Olam. You have others that have Royal Nuts, Singapore, a firm that has done that in West Africa. You have Valencia. They have they've bought assets, production assets, and running processing plants in West Africa. In the agribusiness space, that's happened. I cannot say the same for minerals and metals.
Let's shift gears a little bit now to focus on Nigeria, specifically Nigeria. The Center for African Studies published a 10-year economic roadmap that you, I think, were the primary author of. And this is the first time that a Singapore-based think tank has delivered a policy recommendation report for an African state. And I'm curious about, okay, we're going to get into the details of what the roadmap is, but how did this come about? Is this something that the Nigerians asked you, or was this an interest that you had to make the recommendations? Tell us a little bit about the origins of this 10-year economic roadmap, and then we can get into the findings.
This is a very, very interesting question you've asked, Eric. No, the Nigerians hadn't asked us to produce this report. It came about at the request of a donor that saw our work. That donor, you know, would desist from naming right now, has interest.
Sure, discretion's always important. We appreciate that.
Yes, has a long-standing, you know, multi-sector business in Nigeria. And they could sense that the way the economy was moving was not quite in the direction they would have wanted to see. So it was almost an exercise, you know, out of having been invested in a country, and it comes from a good place, that they came to us and said, could you do something like a roadmap for us? So we looked at what the proposition was, and we came down to the following. You know, Nigeria right now is in the midst of a perfect storm: slowing growth, shrinking revenues, breakdown of security, business confidence is low, the jobs that have been created not enough to provide meaningful employment to the millions who are entering the workforce. Inflation is chipping away the incomes of the everyday Nigerian. And this is driving higher rates of poverty. So there are lots of studies being done, but, you know, but plus or minus, 95 million Nigerians are now classified as extremely poor. So what we did was we did a SWOT analysis. And the report that I have done lays out four critical factors that we believe are likely to determine the economic performance over the next 10 years. The first is the price of oil in the international market. The second is fiscal stability. And that will only be achieved if Nigeria can keep its debt servicing costs within manageable limits. And it controls inflation and manages its balance of payments. And most importantly, reforms the exchange rate regime, right? The third factor identified is infrastructure. Nigeria needs $100 billion every year to improve roads, ports, and power. And that will sustain economic growth. The fourth is, of course, investor confidence. Negative investor sentiment has resulted in a sharp fall in foreign direct investments. That can be seen over a period of 5 years. And corruption, of course, remains a significant barrier to doing business in Nigeria. So what we have done is laid out a roadmap with proposals for action to be done in the first 2 years, then the next 5 years, and then the next 10 years. In the next 10 years, of course, you know, Nigeria's population will balloon. And if it doesn't start by fixing some of its structural problems now, I think getting there will be very difficult. They can get it. They can become one of the world's top 20 economies by 2030. But they need to start taking real hard decision, which, as you have probably seen, President Bola Tinubu has done, although one can criticize whether it could have been done in a better way, the removal of fuel subsidy and so on. But nonetheless, at least the trajectory is in the right direction, and there seems to be some kind of political will behind it.
So can you talk us through the roadmap a little bit? What were some of your key recommendations over these different time spans?
Sure. So in the next 2 years, the top priority is stability. For that, they need to stop the fiscal situation from getting back to worse. How do you do that? Ending fuel subsidy. This is something the government has done. Migrate to a single exchange rate regime. We have given a proposal, which is to be done in phases rather than at one go. The oil theft, that needs to be curbed. Production must be ramped up, because that will then enable the government of Nigeria to get the revenues, which will give them the fiscal room necessary to introduce more reforms. Next 5 years, that will be priority should shift towards reviving growth. And that would mean wholesale structural transformation of the economy. Move away from oil and gas, strengthen other important sectors of the economy, three in particular, agriculture, manufacturing, and services. And that needs private investment. So it needs to, you know, remove the barriers for investments, remove the barriers for the growth of private enterprise, liberalize trade, and end the power crisis. In the next 10 years, Nigeria needs to sustain that. Once the growth is revived, they need to sustain it. Now, that means investing in improving human capital. It needs to strive for good governance and transparency, accountability, anti-corruption efforts, rule of law, specific matters that need to be addressed. So, as a matter of fact, we have given them the frameworks, which we call the Nanyang Governance Improvement Framework, which calls for creating a system within the ministries, departments, and agencies, government agencies, to have a kind of a guidance necessary for all their officials to work according to plan, publish the reports, and so on. So I'll be happy to share this report with you subsequently. You might find it very, very useful as far as Nigeria is concerned. And, you know, we have what we have done towards the end is that we have given targets and recommendations. So the targets, for example, is achieving economic growth of 4.6% by 2025 and 7% by 2030, lifting 100 million people out of poverty within 10 years, creating 21 million full-time jobs by 25. And for that, we have created recommendations. For example, pass legislation to increase VAT rates, abide by the provisions of fiscal responsibility, end oil subsidies, end fuel subsidies, you know, stop funding revenue-generating agencies from the federal budget, increase, and so on and so forth. So there are specific targets, objectives, and recommendations. We've also looked at specific sectors like agriculture, manufacturing, services, and the extractive industry. So there's a whole bunch.
Yeah, what was the reaction sorry to interrupt you. What was the reaction from the Nigerian government or any Nigerian stakeholders when you showed them this 10-year roadmap? What did they think?
Very, very positive. In fact, they have asked us more copies of the report, and there is a very high likelihood that I might be going to Abuja to present this to the finance minister and his team sometime shortly. But that is still something up for discussion.
So your plan, your roadmap kind of outlines these very kind of like large changes that, you know, that would be really transformational. And I think one of the bases from which Southeast Asia has managed to make the kind of leap towards prosperity has been by boosting human capital. And as you say, the African skills base has certainly improved a lot. But I was wondering what kind of recommendations you would make specifically to African countries from the Southeast Asian experience in kind of enriching and improving their skills base.
That essentially is significantly increasing your public expenditure on education. If my memory serves me right, less than 4% of the annual budget of Nigeria really is invested in education. That needs to be ramped up. And so we have made those recommendations. If you look at how a number of countries, including Vietnam for that matter, they spend anything between 16 to 23% of their annual budget. And correct me if I'm wrong, Eric.
That's right. No, new report came out in The Economist saying that same thing, that Vietnam's done incredibly well with education.
Correct. So that is the North Star for countries in sub-Saharan Africa to go for. But to be able to spend that kind of money, first you need to make money. In other words, you know, get the low-hanging fruits first. Fix the immediate problems first before you get there. The window is still there, but it's not going to last any more than, you know, 20 to 30 years. You know, right now, the working age population far exceeds the working age to dependence ratio. As long as it's more than 7, you know, these sub-Saharan African countries like Nigeria are in a sweet spot. They can take advantage of a skilled workforce. Once that falls below 7, then it's very difficult to climb that fast growth, job creating, you know, workforce absorbing trajectory of economic activity. So they have a window, but it'll close fast. And especially if robotics and AI, you know, keeps getting better and cheaper the way it is now, China spending, you know, more than the next 3 countries on robotics combined, then there is a likelihood that, you know, this low-cost manufacturing may not even trickle down any further. The window for that might be closing even faster. So this is something to be worried about, at least.
I agree. I think we're into a new era now where China is not going to offshore as much manufacturing as many people think, because robots are going to make a lot more of the stuff that we buy. And that's even happening here in Southeast Asia. In my son's school, there are a lot of people in the manufacturing space, and they're talking about how they're automating more and more of their production lines, which interestingly is leading to unemployment here in Vietnam. So that means it's even less likely that that manufacturing is going to go even further afield to places like Africa. So that trend's only going to intensify. Another debate that would be great to have you back on the show to talk about is this question that Kenyan economist David Ndii has brought up, and I've mentioned this on the show a number of times, and he's been very critical of the Kenyan government's massive indebtedness to build large-scale infrastructure, a lot of it to China, and not investing in human capital. And he contrasts that with here in Southeast Asia, where the investment, as you've pointed out, in places like Vietnam is in education and healthcare, and specifically also in girls' education too. It's one of the areas where Vietnam has done exceptionally well is in educating girls and then focusing on human capital development rather than hard infrastructure development. So our infrastructure here in Vietnam, not great, but as you pointed out, education, really strong. And that's been driving a lot of that low-end manufacturing. Well, what the heck? I wasn't going to bring it up, but I'd love to get your take on that debate between the big investments in infrastructure versus human capital development.
Oh, absolutely, Eric. But, you know, you'd be surprised. Not all African countries, you know, have done that badly in terms of their investments in human capital.
No, Rwanda is a great example of that.
Exactly. So there are some stars out there that one needs to recognize and give due credit to. I don't think they get a fair attention in the Western media or even in Asia. Because a lot of what we read about Africa here, essentially in one way or the other, is coming out of, you know, the wire services and the media that is concentrated in the West. So that, you know, unfortunately also frames the image about Africa here in Asia. And, you know, one is almost as guilty for not questioning that enough. At least that's what I can say from Singapore.
Well, that's hopefully the work that we're doing is to try to complement some of that and challenge some of those Western media narratives that often tend to be quite negative about Africa and certainly about other parts of the world. Amit Jain is the director of the NTU SBF Center for African Studies at the Nanyang Business School in Singapore. He's one of the smartest guys in the space, particularly in the realm of Southeast Asia-Africa relations. And in fact, he's running Southeast Asia's only think tank dedicated to Africa. So a very interesting space, one that is badly needed. Amit, thank you so much for taking the time to join us and to share your experiences about the conference and your new paper. Congratulations on that. We're looking forward to it, kind of having you come back and talk to us about some of the updates of everything that's been going on. In the meantime, though, if people want to follow you and get in touch to connect with you about the work that you're doing, what's the best way for them to reach you on social media?
Well, you know, I'm active on LinkedIn. So reach out to me at Amit Jain Consultant, linkedin.com/in/Amit Jain Consultant. If you can't find me there, just look for our website, ntu.edu.sg/CAS. That's Center for African Studies. ntu.edu.sg/CAS. You can write to me at amit.jain@ntu.edu.sg.
Well, we'll make this easy for everybody. I'm going to put those in the show notes. So if you didn't get all the dots and W's that Amit was talking about, I'll make sure they're in the show notes so you can reach out directly to Amit on LinkedIn. Amit, once again, thank you so much for your time today. We really appreciate it.
I have enjoyed this conversation very much, Eric. Thank you, Cobus.
Cobus, all I could think about when watching coverage of the Singapore Africa Business Conference take place in Singapore and then listening to Amit talk about it is how quickly the world is changing, how important it is now for stakeholders both here in Southeast Asia but also in Africa to recognize that they have to do a better job at reaching out beyond the traditional spheres of influence with the Chinese, with the Americans, the Japanese, the Indians, and whatnot. And to hear that Temasek, again, a massive multi-billion dollar sovereign wealth fund, one of the largest and most powerful sovereign wealth funds in the world, only has 1% invested in Africa, is, to me, disappointing. And I think, again, there are some huge opportunities for both ASEAN countries and African countries to do better, to get to know one another, because it's an imperative that they do. You cannot rely anymore on the Chinese as being the source of capital and loans. And even now the market, as we see that the Chinese economy is slowing. And when you see a market the size of what we have here in ASEAN, 600 million people, a dynamic market like we have here in Vietnam, in Malaysia, in Indonesia, to me, this just spells huge opportunities for African exporters and also to attract FDI from these countries.
You speak with African stakeholders and you still hear this kind of truism of like, oh, you know, the world is changing. We need to think beyond the West. China is a big player now, you know, whereas China itself is changing. Other players are emerging. It's, you know, kind of things need to move a little quicker. And particularly also in relation to the role of these sovereign wealth funds, it's very interesting to also track how Saudi Arabian investment is moving, because there's, you know, there was these big investments coming both from corporates and from state sovereign wealth funds in Saudi Arabia about massive investments in China and then other in other areas as well. So there's money flowing into China from these different areas, but also, as you say, these massive opportunities in Africa, particularly in relation to renewable energy. The reason I mention renewable energy is because some of these big Saudi investments have really focused on not only energy provision, but then also using that energy to create green hydrogen and other forms of investment. So it's really a very, very fast-moving field.
It is, but the challenge for Southeast Asia and for those trying to come into Southeast Asia and to engage Southeast Asian stakeholders is you cannot simply have an ASEAN strategy the same way you simply cannot have an African strategy. Right? Because engaging Kenya is different than engaging Mali, is different than engaging Egypt, is different than engaging South Africa. And the same applies here in Southeast Asia. That is, when you come into the Vietnamese market, that is not going to be the same strategy that you engage with Thai stakeholders and the same conversations you're going to have, that you're going to have then with the Philippines and Singapore as well. They're so different. So this puts, again, the burden on knowledge production. And it's one of the areas where African policymakers, I think, have fallen short, where they're not using enough knowledge-based, decision-making. I think a lot of it is still based on relationships and patronage and people you know, rather than drawing on pools of information to make decisions that are beyond the traditional, again, the traditional spheres of influence, which in many respects I find in Africa are still very much driven by the West, by, you know, anchored towards Europe and towards the United States. And I think looking at ASEAN is difficult, but it is potentially very, very rewarding. And I really hope that in my supermarket here in Ho Chi Minh City, we're going to see more than just South African pears and apples and oranges, but we're going to see South African wines, we're going to see Kenyan avocados, we're going to see a wide range of products coming from Africa, even beyond just basic agriculture, but to a wider diversity of products. And I think that this is a market that is growing. It's big, it's getting wealthier. In the 10 years that I've been in Vietnam, you can't imagine the transformation that's taken place. And it's a kind of thing that you would love to see more African countries be a part of this growth.
Absolutely. You know, and also, of course, more and more, you know, cross investments into manufacturing and other fields. I think it's all really crucial. And I think, you know, a newer wave of policymakers will probably move more quickly in that direction. I think what the challenge is, and, you know, and this sounds mean, but I think what the challenge is frequently is for African countries to make sure that they have the politicians that actually care about development, that their politicians actually care about their people getting richer.
That's a given in a lot of states. I don't think that's a given.
Which is not a given. It's not a given in African countries necessarily. You know, so there lies the real issue. And the countries in Southeast Asia that do have those leaders are doing very well, but not all of them have. You know, a country like Myanmar, I think, you know, can't necessarily be that that bothered about how, you know, how development is going to work. So it comes down a lot to political will and having the right leaders. But, you know, African countries are generally united by a young population that tend to be quite enthusiastic about democracy. You know, so in that sense, I think, you know, that is encouraging. And in that sense, I also, I think, overlap with Southeast Asia.
Well, yes and no. This is a part of the world where democracy is definitely in retreat. Vietnam is not a democracy. Cambodia is not a democracy. Laos, Myanmar. So this is not a great democracy story right here in many respects. So, and in many ways, Singapore, you know, they call themselves a democracy, but, you know, it's hard. I found living in Singapore to be far more restrictive than living in China.
Maybe democracy is the wrong word. You know, I'm a big fan of democracy, but maybe what we're talking about is maybe representative governance. You know, is some form of like the younger people and the actual aspirations of a broader part of the population are translated into policy. You know, that isn't necessarily democracy, but it tends to be more effective in well-functioning democracies.
That being said, all of the countries on my list of non-democracies, that doesn't happen either. I mean, these are authoritarian dictatorships in many respects.
But I mean, maybe again, to refine it a little bit more, like the point you were making earlier during the conversation about the amount of investment that Vietnam is putting into education.
Yeah.
I would count that as an example of that. It's like where these kind of the needs of the broad base of the population are taken on board in a policy way, even if the policymaking process is not democratic. You know, like obviously this is a kind of a field of gray areas, but you know, like what you see sometimes in African countries where is just a complete indifference to what the general population would need.
Well, I would put this up to competent governance. And in that respect, I think it's just, or effective governance. And in some ways, Vietnam has been very good at that, particularly in the education and also in agricultural reform. People are fed here. And that's not a given that people have food in this country. In the 1990s, when I lived in Hong Kong, my first impression of Vietnam was famine and boat people. And so the fact that Vietnam has been able to transition from the mid-90s to being a famine-stricken country, bloated bellies, people leaving, people said, if you send me back to Vietnam, it's a death sentence. That was how bad it was here. And in the space of the time from the mid-90s to today, where you don't see anywhere near that, people are fed, that's quite remarkable. It's very impressive. And in that respect, I think that's effective governance.
Exactly. I think there also lies a really important overlap between the Southeast Asian and African experiences, is that both come from an experience of trauma. You know, both are freshly from historical trauma. And the way that Southeast Asia managed to wield that and work with it and not be destroyed by it, I think is really interesting and important to learn.
Well, and again, the trauma is very fresh. When we think about Cambodia and the killing fields, that's just the 1970s. So this is in very many ways, as you said, parallel some of the traumas that were experienced in Africa with decolonization in the 70s as well. And so then the traumas of the 80s.
Well, you know, kind of the Congolese War and the Rwandan tragedies is in the late 90s.
Well, that's right. And the Cold War played out here. I mean, the war in Vietnam was no better manifestation of that, of how the Cold War was tragic here. Speaking of the Cold War, and again, this is a point that I think is very important to bring up with African governments, and when we have the chance to talk with policymakers, I make this point all the time, that I think that Africans should be looking to countries like Vietnam for how they manage their relationships with the United States and with China. There are no better examples of countries that have perfected, better than anybody else, managing great power relationships here in Asia than the Vietnamese and now the Filipinos and others. And I think there are great lessons for other countries, particularly in Africa, to watch how the Vietnamese and their hedging strategy has been incredibly, incredibly effective. I mean, picture this. The Vietnamese prime minister went up to Beijing to meet with Xi Jinping at the same weekend when the USS aircraft carrier Ronald Reagan was docked in Da Nang. That is just, I mean, like, man, I mean, that's it right there. It's like, you know, I'm here to say hello to you, Mr. Xi, but my friends are parked in Da Nang. And this is the front line here. If World War III breaks out, it's going to happen in the South China Sea and it's going to happen in Southeast Asia. And again, we are writing about this every single day now with what's happening between the Philippines and China and the South China Sea, and how the United States keeps reminding everybody that even water cannon attacks from the China Coast Guard onto Philippine naval vessels does qualify under the Mutual Defense Treaty. How terrifying is that, right? That we are getting closer and closer to the United States and China actually having conflict. It's going to happen here. So looking at how these countries are managing this incredibly complex dynamic right now, I think there are a lot of lessons for Kenya, for Ghana, and for others that have stated over and over again that they do not want to be caught up in the great power rivalries. There are real lessons to be learned from these countries here that are on the front lines of that.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. I think in that sense, you know, concentrating on these countries, both in Southeast Asia and in Africa as actors, is really important. Also symbolically, because what it does is it takes the story that the history of the world is the history of these two big powers kind of fighting it out for dominance. It takes that story away from those two powers. You know, that's not the history of the world. That's not our story. It's, you know, it's like my story isn't the story of a US-China conflict. You know, sorry, that's not my world. And I think concentrating on all of these other countries really makes that powerful, I think.
And the last point on this is India, because India has been seeking to deepen its engagement here in Southeast Asia. And that's another dynamic to watch as well. Another reason why it would be great to see more African participation in ASEAN and more ASEAN participation in the African Union and the AFCFTA. So there's just so much potential. The need is there. The opportunities are there. And it's something that we hope in this show and the service that we're doing will help facilitate that through greater understanding about some of the core issues that are aligned on both sides. Again, very quickly, there was the African Climate Summit this week. You and I are going to have a lot of opinions on it. You know, looking at some of the key messaging that's coming out of it, I think it was, for me, another predictable disappointment of a climate summit. I think these climate summits are a complete joke and a waste of time. Think about the carbon footprint of 300,000 people flying into Kenya for this summit.
Yeah, in an era when we have Zoom.
This boggles the mind that this is the only way we can do these things. And yet nothing seems to come out of it. And here we have COP28 coming up in, you know, the United Arab Emirates. I mean, these people have a sense of humor, at least, you know. And so, again, my frustration comes out of it, the fact that there is a lot of talking, a lot of agenda pushing, not a lot of action. And the time for talking is done. It's done. The world is burning now. We're in it. Do you know what I mean? I mean, we're still having the same conversations as if climate change is something that's going to happen, you know, one day down the road in the future. And here we are. And I listened to William Ruto's speech, you know, the opening speech, the keynote address that he gave on Tuesday. And I just was thinking to myself, are you effing kidding me? I mean, he's talking about hopey, changey, and we can come together. And I come back, Cobus, to things that you have said on this, that the rich countries are going to pay for this one way or another. They can either pay now or they can pay later. And if they pay now, it's probably going to be a lot cheaper than when they pay later in the form of mass migration, mass disruption, potential terrorism, and all the dislocation that's going to come in the global south from climate change when people run out of food, water, and wars and conflicts will start because of the changes in the environment.
Yeah.
And I just don't understand why there's not more anger from the likes of William Ruto. And to basically start putting a knife to the throat of the West and saying, guess what, guys? Stop with the rhetoric. Stop with the loans. Stop with all the cheap talk and get to doing something. Because if you don't, guess what's going to happen? The Mediterranean is going to be flooded with people coming into your neighborhood.
Yeah, no, I can imagine all of the different reasons why someone like William Ruto isn't saying that right now, but I don't think they're necessarily very good reasons. I think the reality needs to be made clear in a lot starker terms, you know, but yeah, we're heading into the fray, you know, so let's see.
And these moronic climate activists, okay, who are still thinking that the West or the rich countries are going to fork over $100 billion a year of loss and damage funds. Come on. Like, they're not paying attention. 70 some odd percent of Republicans don't even believe that climate change exists. right? So if that is the reality we're dealing with, then nothing gets through the U.S. Congress under any circumstances. China has said it's not going to pay for loss and damage. So why are we having conversations about $100 billion a year? Lunacy. I mean, just lunacy. I just don't get it. And I think this is the problem with these conferences, is they get hijacked by these rhetorics and these narratives instead of talking about the realities as they are, which is grim and getting grimmer.
Well, a big group of climate NGOs wrote this very interesting big open letter about the African Climate Summit, in which they were saying that the agenda of the climate summit was essentially hijacked by McKinsey, and that the agendas that are being suggested, or the solutions that are being suggested, are really leaning towards things like carbon sequestration rather than the much more radical solutions that are being called for by actual Africans on the ground. So, you know, I mean, it's all of these things are... Yeah, it's bad to us. Let's see.
Let me read you a comment from a climate analyst who deals with the South Pacific. Unfortunately, I don't want to name him because I haven't asked permission for him to read this, but he wrote, "This is a hustle." He's in Nairobi for the African Climate Summit. He wrote, "This is a hustle. All my optimism dashed by what is essentially another top-down consent program driven by big conservation. The spirit of a new Africa vision remains shackled to U.S. interests." That's from a climate analyst.
What does he mean by big conservation?
Well, I think that's the big NGOs, the big northern NGOs who are driving their agenda, and there's not an African perspective, there's not an African voice that's being amplified in all of this. It's being overwhelmed by the Western narratives. That's what I think he means by it. And I can see it. Can absolutely see it. Where is the anger, though? I mean, here in the Mekong Delta, I was just in the Mekong Delta this weekend. Okay. The farmers are saying that their rice production is going down because salt levels are going up in the marshes. Because the Mekong Delta is effectively at sea level. This is a part of the world that is a major rice bowl for much of Southeast Asia, feeding hundreds of millions of people. If the Mekong Delta goes dry because of salt levels in the marshes, what's going to happen? I'm baffled by the fact that there's not more outrage over this. Because no one in the Mekong Delta is the reason for this happening, right? They didn't cause this. They're not driving big F-150 trucks and having massive refrigerators and, you know, three homes and, you know, 700 square meter apartments that are air conditioned 24 hours a day. It's not how they live. I can't understand why there's not more outrage.
I think there's plenty of outrage, but I think the people who are feeling it, they feel so siloed and so disempowered that they feel that they are the only ones who feel it. I think many, many people feel it. But, you know, that's part of the situation we're in at the moment, is where every single person is suffering under that on their own. And there isn't a set of kind of collective voices coming through.
Well, I hope there is. And I hope that, you know, because this is a joke. And these climate conferences are a joke, and people are dying and people are suffering, and they're still pretending as if there's time. And I mean, we've got David McNair from the One Campaign coming up, and I know he's frustrated with a bunch of things related to debt and climate. And so we're going to talk to him about his new report and things like that. But honestly, another climate summit came and went this week. And what does it have to show? Good for Kenyan tourism, by the way. Fantastic for Kenyan tourism.
The thing is that I completely feel the futility and the anger of it. You know, kind of I certainly feel marinated in that on a daily basis. The reality, though, is also that what needs to be set up in order to deal with the climate crisis in any real way is cross-cutting global systems, right? Which means that there isn't really any getting around having to set up how those things are going to work. So, you know, I completely share the kind of anger at the kind of performativity of all of this and the kind of deludedness of some of it. But at the same time, you know, kind of in order to move forward, the world is going to have to set up some kind of way of dealing with them. The way that we, for example, now have, you know, a shipping system that kind of works despite many countries having many of their own issues. International shipping still works, right, as a global system. In a similar way, we're going to have to deal with the buying and selling of carbon, for example, in a way that is coherent globally. So We need A, to have these meetings in order to set up how that's going to work. And then we also need real engagement with how the rules are being made, because as these climate NGOs are pointing out in Kenya, there are very powerful interests, including Western governments, Western corporations, and, you know, kind of players like China and India, who have very kind of narrow set of concerns that they have a kind of a tunnel vision with, that are trying to kind of warp how these systems are going to work in ways to enrich themselves. So there is a need for everyone to be engaged with what the decisions that are actually made at these conferences, because otherwise, you know, like it's not enough to say, oh, these conferences are a waste of time. Like I certainly see the waste of time aspect to it, but there isn't really any way around the big need to set up big new systems. And so here we are, you know, kind of like it's a very, very kind of corrupt situation, but there's no real other way of moving forward.
Yeah, but Cobus, do you really think that Russia, okay, that makes most of its money from selling coal and gas and oil, is going to sign on for any of this stuff? Do you think the United States, the largest fossil fuel producer in the world, is going to sign up for this? No. Saudi Arabia, what are they going to do? This isn't going to happen, Cobus.
Well, the thing is, you know, as we cover these things, you know, exhaustively on a day-to-day basis, right? And we see these obstructions happening. You know, my own country, South Africa, is a particularly kind of problematic player in all of this. But at the same time, what we're also seeing is every day new solar deals, new wind deals, new renewable energy. More people are making more money out of renewable energy now than they did a month before. And more of them are going to be making it soon. So, yeah, it's slow. It sucks, you know.
It's slow, but again, this to me is small. I mean, this is using a garden hose to put out a forest fire. And it's like, yeah, there's solar deals. Again, my frustration is that I think developing countries have to start speaking far more assertively and aggressively and starting to articulate the real dangerous consequences to the perpetrators of this violence on the environment, about what the consequences will be if they start running out of food and how it's going to directly impact them. And I don't think that case is being made. And I think that these leaders who don't necessarily represent their people, again, William Ruto, joke what his speech was. Wrong speech, wrong time, wrong tone. He needed to say, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming to Nairobi. Time is up. We're past now being polite and talking about, you know, working together collaboratively, because the Russians, the Saudis, the Americans, the Norwegians, the Canadians, the Australians, who make bucket loads of money on carbon, are not going to play. And the Chinese have said they're not going to play, despite all the lofty, fancy, fun rhetoric that the Chinese talk about in terms of global South solidarity. BS, they put 21 gigawatts of new coal power online this year. That's what they're doing. 21 gigawatts. I mean, that's just, okay. I don't know what to say. I mean, it's what do you say? They're not serious about this issue. And I think that's where the Global South has to start making its voice heard more and not pretending that these wealthier Global North countries are going to be nice and play along with them and giving them $100 billion a year. Are you freaking kidding me? God, the delusion.
I think Global South governments also know how the global media works. Right, because the person who's going to be making those threats will immediately be turned into...
They'll get more airtime. In our social media age, they'll get tons of airtime. And remember, you can control your own media now. It's not like it was in the old days.
But people know they'll be turned into the crazy one from the Global South, right? Kind of they'll be immediately be trivialized and called a terrorist, and you know, and so, you know, there's no winning here, you know. So in that sense,
but this is what these supposed multilateral groups are supposed to do. This is where the African Union can speak with the voice, where ASEAN can speak with the voice, where the Inter-American States can speak with the voice on behalf of their member states.
You know what? You know where I really agree with you. I think that one of the most like pernicious kind of narratives that we hear so often is this narrative of like, oh, global warming, you know what's the worst about global warming is most vulnerable people will suffer the most. Like, sure, that's true. But at the same time, that's such a convenient narrative that keeps things so stuck in where they are in the global north. The reality is the global north is going to suffer plenty. The global north is going to be burning.
They already are suffering plenty. I actually thought you were going to go with the polar bears more than you were going to say the people.
You know, so in that sense, like, I think the global north is going to have to get a lot more scared. And so we'll see how that goes. You know, like the resistance to being scared is thick in the global north, you know, but let's see. Things are scary. Things are going to get scarier. Let's see how it goes.
Again, we did not plan to tack on a whole other show on this. I've been fuming about this all week, and I'm disappointed that we didn't have our show, my chance to talk about it earlier this week. So here I had to let it out just to
blow up some steam.
You know, so we're going to do more on this climate stuff. And again, it's just all about the urgency and the time for politeness is over, but also a recognition of the reality of the politics today. And let me just bring you back to that 70%+ of Republicans in the United States don't believe that climate change is serious or even happens. Now, you can dismiss that and just laugh at it and say, well, that's, you know, the Republicans, why do they count? Because at the end of the day, if that number of people doesn't believe in it, it's not going to get anything through the Congress. And the Congress is what releases money. And so if you wanted $100 billion of annual restitution for climate violence, then some of that's going to have to come from the United States. As long as 70%+ Republicans don't buy into it, it ain't going to happen. Okay? And so the politics of the moment are such that even in Western Europe, and I'd be interested for you to have some conversations in Germany, is there an appetite to be shipping off billions of dollars to the global south in climate payments, when in fact the priority in Western Europe is just to keep the brown and black people on their side of the Mediterranean, and immigration is the main issue, not climate. Now, that is part of the reason to say you have to deal with this on climate because you're going to have an immigration crisis later. That's a very compelling argument that I think would find resonance in Europe. Okay?
I think that it is finding resonance in Europe from what I've gauged, but you know that's and then mobilizing the actual resources
two very different things,
right?
You see what we've been able to do with the war in Ukraine. So it shows that when the motivations are there and the demand is there, we can mobilize tens of billions of dollars very quickly, very very quickly. So we have a capacity to do this if we want to. I'm just not convinced that the political will is there to do it. And that's clearly what we've been seeing. So, okay, let the blood pressure calm down a little bit. Did not anticipate having this kind of conversation. You can see what Cobus and I just have. Our normal conversations are like this. And it's so easy for us to kind of just take a left turn and just go down these kind of rabbit holes. But nonetheless, so thank you for indulging us on a little detour on climate issues. Again, we have a lot of climate coverage planned now. Here in Southeast Asia, we've got our Southeast Asia correspondent, Antonia Timmerman, who's doing this amazing work in working with contributors around Southeast Asia to amplify voices on the impact of Chinese development here in Southeast Asia. Some positive, some negative. Again, it's a mix of both. We have all of that available on our site. Also, Njinga Hakina, based out of Nairobi, is doing the same in Africa. If, by the way, you are an African civil society expert, a journalist, a writer, anybody, and you would like to, you know, contribute to earn a little bit of money and to write some thought pieces on this, we have some opportunities. Go to our website at chinaglobalsouth.com, look at the very bottom of the site, and you'll see our jobs page. And we've got a job description there for writers in Asia and in Africa to do some contributions to this discourse. So we'd love to hear from you. And we've got some other fantastic jobs available. So if you want to join our amazing team in Asia, Africa, and the Middle East, please look at our jobs page over on our website. And if you'd like to support our work, we would be so grateful for you to subscribe to the China Global South Project. Subscriptions are very affordable. Go to chinaglobalsouth.com/subscribe. We'll give you 30 days free. And of course, if you are a student or a teacher, you get half off. Just email me, Eric@chinaglobalsouth.com. For Cobus van Staden in Berlin, I'm Eric Olander. We'll be back again next week with another edition of the China in Africa podcast. Until then, thank you so much for listening.
The discussion continues online. Tag us on Twitter at ChinaGSProject and visit us at ChinaGlobalSouth.com. If you speak French, check out our full coverage at ProjetAfriqueChine.com and AfriqueChine on Twitter. That's Afrique with a K. And you'll also find links to our sites and social media channels in Arabic.